1922, the tempo of the city had changed sharply. The buildings were higher, the parties were bigger, the morals were looser and the liquor was cheaper. The restlessness approached hysteria.
Shall we?
Who is this Gatsby?
Do you know him?
War hero.
Mr. Gatsby doesn't exist.
Gatsby? What Gatsby?
I beg your pardon. Mr. Gatsby would like to speak to you. Alone.
You know, everything we know about Jay Gatsby, we know from Nick's point of view, from his perspective, you know, kind of from him firsthand. One day, when your story is told, if someone you know was going to be writing your story, from whose perspective would you be most interested in seeing kind of what they have to say about you?
Ironically, the person that plays Nick in this movie.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, he's somebody that, you know, Toby, I've known for 25 years. You know, we grew up in this industry together. I've watched him becoming the father that he is, the man that he is, also create his own career and vice versa. We've known each other since we were, you know, 13 years old, which is pretty amazing. I don't have that many long-lasting friendships in my life, and ironically, he'd be the Nick Carraway that would. I'd be curious to see his interpretation of what my life was, or and vice versa.
You know, we were just talking about the fact that I'm a big fan of The Great Gatsby, and a few years ago, after years of searching, I found a book called Trimacchio.
Yeah.
Which you know, I guess you could call it like the director's cut of Great Gatsby. It's a little bit darker and a little bit sinister, and I felt that was the Gatsby that you kind of went after.
Very
and
much so.
So I was kind of curious, if you're on set, you have Trimacchio on one hand, you have The Great Gatsby on the other, which is more sacred to you as an actor?
I think we gave them both equal respect. The truth is that what makes Trimacchio is a great book, but you know, The Great Gatsby is a masterpiece because of what is edited out of Trimacchio, what's left unsaid, what's left for you as a reader to sort of fill in the blanks and interpret in your own way. But I think that when you make a film version of a great novel like this, you as an actor, as a detective, you get more insight into the character's thought process or what Fitzgerald originally intended for these characters' interactions to be. So I gave them sort of equal weight in a lot of ways, but it gave me a lot of insight into what, you know, the great tragedy that Gatsby was,
right,
and Fitzgerald's intent for, a lot of these scenes. And so it was a huge benefit,
right,
for us, and we really carried it on set every single day in making this movie.
If you could sit in a theater with F. Scott Fitzgerald and watch The Great Gatsby, and when it's done, kind of lean over and say, did I get this part about him right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the aspect that you would want to ask him about?
Well, to me, you know, reading this novel as a 15-year-old and then rereading as an adult, it was a completely different experience.
It really is. I had the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, I remember it being this, you know, sort of... you know, this romance, this man that was obsessed with this woman named Daisy, and they came from different class structures, and Gatsby created himself according to his own imagination. But I didn't quite get the hollowness, mm-hmm, of Gatsby. He's really this empty shell, and he's holding on to this relic that is Daisy, this illusion, this green light. She's basically a mirage, and he's completely not in touch with reality.
Right.
And that was a real awakening for me as an actor and as a reader. To pick the novel up again as an adult, and that's what I really wanted to infuse into this performance and this version of The Great Gatsby.
Mr. DiCaprio, if you ever come through Houston, I have a very comfortable fold-out couch, so you're always more than welcome to it, my friend. An
Thank
honor
you.
To get to sit across from you. Thank you
Thank
very much
you
for
very
your
much.
Time.
Thank
I know your time's limited, so I appreciate it.
When I made the pleasure of Mr. Gatsby's acquaintance, I discovered a man of fine breeding.
Very interesting. Everything all right?
Yes.
So, you know, we always talk with actors that are in movies based on classic books, and they always say, oh yes, I read the book and I did so much research and everything, and I was wondering, could there ever be a benefit to not reading the book? Would you ever consider going into a movie like this and just completely ignoring the source material?
I don't think so. I certainly think that a lot of this is working with, your collaborators, so working with Baz and Leo and Catherine Martin and the other actors. But the truth is, you're sifting through this really rich material to get hints and clues and also actually use the material so much of what we did was informed by the book and is the book, you know.
Right.
So it would be hard for me to imagine doing that.
Okay.
It's like, you know, ignoring a great resource.
Right, exactly. That's true. I was just kind of curious, experiment-wise.
It's possible. It's possible, particularly like, you know, when you're talking about tonally, because you could really, you know, take a leap or make a great departure. But if you're adapting something or if you're making something that is from source material,
right,
it'd be hard to do if you weren't familiar with source material.
That's true. Now, obviously, for Nick Carraway, the events that take place during The Great Gatsby are the most important events of his life. That's why he sits and writes that whole story. If you were today going to sit down and just write a story about the most important events in your life, that made you who you are, what are the events you'd write about today?
Well, I think there would be a lot of events that I would write about. Certainly my childhood and the kind of circumstances I grew up in, and then a few pivotal moments in my life that were turning points. Some of that was in my teenage years when I kind of figured out my direction in life, and then had certain teachers who helped develop some attitudes for me, and then of course meeting my wife and having my kids. Going through the sort of seminal moments in my life.
Where in your book will I be?
You will be, I think we should start it out with you.
Nice, and then just do like a flashback.
That's right.
Really quick, I just wanted to ask you, I always love this idea of voiceovers and the fact that voiceovers can kind of tell what characters are really thinking that in the moment you may not be able to tell. If you were gonna do a voiceover of me looking at you, you looking at me, what would your voiceover right now be saying?
Well, first of all, let me say that whether this is voiceover or not, what I was thinking of as you were saying that is actually with the way you think and what your abilities are, you could be the voiceover of my life.
That would be the best thing ever.
There you go.
Oh my God, I could talk to you all day, Mr. Maguire. Seriously,
right,
an honor when you come through Houston, man.
All right, excellent.
You're
Thank
in.
You.
You're
Fold
there.
Out couch.
Fold
I'm
out
there.
Couch. All right, brother. I'll talk to you soon, man.
Good to see you.
I'm certainly glad to see you again.
I'm certainly glad to see you as well.
All the details that we know about the characters from Gatsby, we kind of get from Nick's perspective. Mm. If he doesn't see it, we really don't know about it. So I was wondering, what is something you'd like to know about Daisy that we just can't because Nick didn't see it firsthand?
The one thing that I loved about, we had one scene really where Joel and I, Tom Buchanan and Daisy, get to have kind of this sort of teasing dynamic. And I loved that. I loved how she tries to rile him up and he sort of puts her down. But they, as much as, you know, it's a really sad relationship they have, it's kind of fun. And I think they kind of like it.
Right.
And I would have loved to have done more of that. I think seeing Daisy and Tom just living their lives, you know, before this whole whirlwind starts, I think would be kind of interesting.
Spin-off?
I mean, I think, yeah, potentially.
Spin-off?
Joel's available,
right.
I'm available.
Exclusive in this interview right now? All
yes.
right, all right, I thought so. Now, honestly, it's so beautifully tragic to see everything that Gatsby does for Daisy, the parties and the shirts and the cars and the house and everything. Mm. What is the most incredible thing a guy has done to impress you?
Oh, this shirt would probably be the most, honestly, I don't think anyone's ever done anything like too specifically. I'm very easily impressed.
I'm both complimented and like,
no.
I'm not quite sure
but
to take
is,
that.
This is standing out as a pivotal moment.
We would be a beautiful couple.
And your hair.
I'm just saying, I gotta be professional.
I will say you are the most pristine person who's walked in this room today.
If I weren't mic'd into this chair, I would come over and just hug the heck out of you right now. Just because, wait till the cameras are off. Wait till this interview's over. You know, so much of this movie is about this idea of not being able to let go, of not being able to move on. So I was wondering, what is that role that you've had or that movie that you've been in that you had the hardest time walking away from?
100% like The Seagull. I did a production of The Seagull in London and on Broadway, and I played Nina, and it was my favorite experience of my, it was my favorite job ever. And
What was it about the role that was hard to let go of?
It was just, it's the most well-written role for an actress in her 20s or 30s just ever written. Mm. And that was what was so amazing about Gatsby, is that sometimes you get to play a part where the language that you get to use is just such a privilege. And to be able to say things like, that's all a girl in this world should be, a beautiful little fool. Like, in most films, you don't get that kind
right.
of, you know, the dialogue is not like that. So I really relished that in The Seagull, and I really relished it in Gatsby.
It's so funny you bring up that line, because it happens to be the line that's the next aspect of my question. It's almost like we planned this. It's obviously one of the most famous lines of the book, one of the most beautifully written. So I was wondering, in this business, in what is it beneficial to maybe be a little bit of a fool in this business?
No, I think you have to be pretty savvy. I mean, I don't really sort of, I'm very kind of unbusiness minded, and I don't make choices about sort of business. I do things that I really love and that have amazing directors or kind of amazing cast. But I think, no, I think you've got to be pretty smart, and I think you've got to be kind of tough. And I think, you know, people, even if they're, you know, they seem to be incredibly beautiful, they're all sort of smart, hardworking people. I think you've got to work hard or you just sort of fall away.
And that's why you are where you are. I could talk with you all day. I'd ask you to marry me if I thought you'd say yes. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
You always look so cool. The man in the cool, beautiful shirt.
To tell him she never loved him.
I would love to see Baz's version of anything. The fact that he took on Great Gatsby and he's taken on Romeo and Juliet is gorgeous. If you could see Baz's version of a film that you've done in the past, which one would you like to see him, like, you know, his version of?
Oh. His version of? That's an awesome idea.
I did a movie called The Night We Called It a Day, and it was it had a different title here. It was called All the Way.
Right.
And it was about a true time in Australian history when Frank Sinatra came to Australia and was boycotted by the unions because he supposedly spat on a female journalist. I want Baz to remake that story.
Oh, I've never heard that story before. I need to go check that movie out.
It's almost like too perfectly true, perfectly set for a movie. I mean, anyway, I'm going to shut up right now.
That's awesome.
Have to go with Confession of a Shopaholic, because even though it was what it was, Baz would love the costumes and, you know, film everything in such a sparkly way.
It would be beautiful. It would be beautiful. Now, guys, I have to be honest. My entire life, even as a kid, I was always obsessed with kind of like the jazz age, like America in the 1920s. So I was wondering, what is that aspect from that era that you think would best suit you? And what is the aspect that you'd be like, you know what? Can't do it.
Aspect of the era that would best suit me would be economic growth. I'd love it if we had a big right now boom and we didn't have so much unemployment everywhere.
Nice. Sweet. That's a much better answer. I thought it was going to be like dresses or something. That's a much better answer than I thought it was going to be. No, that's great. That's a great answer.
Yeah, now I'm under a lot of pressure to
don't
say
the suits,
something
dude.
Really relevant. the cars. I don't know. All I know is that if I was living in that age, I'd probably have an issue with liver disease.
Jesus,
you wouldn't. It'd be like, "Where's Joel? He's in the speakeasy. Get him out of there."
Let's be honest. That's not coffee in that Starbucks cup, is it?
No. Oh, no. In any of these vessels here.
And
no.
See, he puts them in different bottles, so we're all like, "Oh, look, he wants a little bit of water. He wants a little bit of Coke."
Yeah.
We're not fooled.
Yeah, we hung out in Houston, man. I got you.
Yeah.
I got your back.
Yeah, you know, he knows stories.
I know him. We've had good talks.
All right.
Honestly, between this movie coming out and then last year we got Les Mis and Life of Pi, my entire high school reading curriculum is now up on the big screen. So, I was wondering, what is that book that you read in high school that you would love the new big flashy on-screen version of?
Summer of the 17th Doll?
I've never read that.
That was a good, that was a
it's
play.
It's Australian.
What would you like to?
It's written in English.
okay, good to know. Excellent. Write that down.
I don't know if there's, I'd be very honest right now and say that I'm not an avid reader.
So, that's okay. Nothing wrong with that.
Some of those early books, you know, they'd make very short movies like the one I mentioned earlier.
What did you mention?
Kids' book called The Caterpillar That Ate Everything. It's wonderful. It's a hard book, but there's little holes in the pages because this little caterpillar eats everything.
It'd be a great movie, actually. Really would. Who'd play the caterpillar?
I know. I could be the butterfly.
Yeah.
Well, obviously. I mean, because butterflies are beautiful.
Oh, that's
ooh,
so sweet.
Ooh, shucks.
See what I did there?
We're having a moment.
You guys get a room. Actually, we're in one.
Yeah, go away, Joel.
You're at the plaza. I'm leaving.
Yeah, right?
I'll just not.
We're in the Plaza Hotel in New York City.
You guys carry on.
Guys, I could talk to you all day. Come back to Houston. Come
see
to Houston.
You.
And join. I have a very comfortable fold-out couch, so you guys are more than welcome. You guys are more. I'll see
I'm
you
there.
In New Orleans in a few weeks.
Yeah, let's exchange numbers now.
All right, we're in. Right, see you guys soon. Thank you.
I've just heard the most shocking thing. It all makes sense.
Will you come on tour? We need you.
I wish we could just run away.
Mr. Gatsby, sir.
Not now.
I feel feel like one of the themes of the novel is the fact that Gatsby builds up Daisy so much in his mind that it's impossible for Daisy to actually live up. Do you ever fear that we were talking about people that you know this book belongs to, that they're going to build it up so much like Gatsby does with Daisy, that there's just going to be no way to please them?
There will be people I can't please,
right?
Of course, and which is why I had to block out all that noise about expectation or, oh, he's doing it in 3D, oh, hip-hop, oh, it's all gonna be flash and dazzle. Listen, the film Gatsby is flash and dazzle,
right?
The character, but at the end, it's, you know, Leonardo and Joel Edgerton and Tobey Maguire and Kerry Mulligan, you know, and lovely Elizabeth Debicki in a room in this hotel.
Mm-hmm. This hotel, exactly. We're in the Plaza Hotel in New York,
by
the way.
7 minutes.
Right.
Just acting, tearing each other's emotions apart. It couldn't be more minimal.
Right.
And that's the book, and that's what I try to do, is follow and reveal the book now, though, for this audience.
Right. I'm curious, as a director, when you're going through the book, what sort of attributes or what sort of aspects does a passage or a scene have to have for you to say, I'm not going to put that in there, or I'm going to change that?
That's a good question. That's a really good question. You know, if you read the book, we know the lovely elevator company's done a 7-hour version. And you know, if you read that 7-hour, we can't do a 7-hour film.
Right.
We could.
We'd still be watching it. Yeah, exactly. With the director's cut.
Now, there's an idea.
Yeah. Magic's happening, Bass.
But in 2 hours, the first thing Craig Pierce and I did was go through and say, what scenes can we do without? Now, I think it's a revelatory scene. It's after Myrtle's party, they go down in the elevator and there's a whole McKee's there and the photo book, and you think, wow, that's far out. And then he's in the train station. Mm. It's great, but you can do without it.
Right.
And it was very hard because I shot a lot of scenes. The Blu-ray coming soon, mm-hmm, will have a lot of scenes that I shot after Gatsby's death.
Really? I was going to ask you, the funeral scene, because I was really anxious to see that.
I shot.
So what made you choose not to include the funeral?
Because what happened was, as I worked on the film more and more, I realized that the moment you introduced him, no matter how good a scene, anything after Gatsby's death, you stole from the idea of re-internalizing in Nick's head and making it about just everyone abandons Gatsby and there's just Nick and Gatsby, Nick and a dead man, Nick and a dead man. And in the novel it can work because you can come back and ruminate, but I had to keep it really, I wanted to go down into a singular internal voice. Starts internal, it goes out, and becomes, it becomes open, and then I wanted to, it was better to just keep it focused.
And it did seem right, and then the ending was, I could talk to you all day, but the ending was fantastic. Seriously, it's an honor to sit across from you. When you come to Houston, I have a very comfortable fold-out couch.
Good. Well, if you keep dressing the Gatsby styling like that, I shall certainly be turning up,
right,
my friend.
Mr. Luhrmann, an honor, sir. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate
it. It's cool to talk to you.
Thank you.
Man.
Appreciate it.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Love is goodness.
Are you trying to cause in my house?
I wish I'd done everything on earth with you.